Now, since you've been favoring us with your time, we'll try to favor you with some perspective on this key issue that faces us. What to do about the one, not with the Q, but with the N, Iran, the country the U.S. suspects of developing nuclear weapons. Iran's U.N. ambassador said late this week his country wants to work directly with the U.S. to resolve the nuclear issue. But first, the U.S. has to agree that Iran has a right to nuclear technology for peaceful purposes. U.S. officials reject talks unless Iran stops enriching uranium. Joining me with a special perspective is the Iranian-French journalist Leila Azamzanganeh, who's recently edited a collection of essays about contemporary Iranian culture and politics. Welcome, Leila.
Thank you.
So here we are again, another Middle Eastern country that looks dangerous, looks spooky. What can we learn about the U.S. experience in Iraq that might help us find a path forward in Iran?
Well, certainly one of the first things that we can learn from the Iraqi experience is that violence does not work. Antagonizing the people of the Middle East does not work. Unfortunately, the more you call them evil, the more you refuse to engage in dialogue, the more you conjure up a reality that perhaps didn't quite exist in that way before you pronounce those words.
It's hard to be friendly, though, with that Iranian regime. I mean, they are pretty extreme, and it makes it easier for the Bush administration to wedge Iran into their axis of evil paradigm when the president of Iran says things like, the Holocaust is a myth.
Of course. It's a tricky situation. It's infinitely difficult in terms of diplomacy, but it's also vital at this point for the American government to try and engage them in a way. There was a letter, as you know, that was published by Mr. Ahmadinejad to President Bush a few weeks ago.
The famous 18-page letter from the Iranian president.
Exactly. And that letter, in reality, was reeking with insecurity and inferiority complex, and those people, they're just waiting to be addressed. And the more you address them, even if it's in a diplomatic way, even if you're playing games and you know you never lose track of who you're really talking to, that's how you're going to break the ice and be able to make progress. And that's a more cunning and probably a more efficient way to get out of the deadlock today.
You see these signs of insecurity in that famous letter. Do you think it's the president of Iran, or do you think it is symbolic of a deeper insecurity that you might see more pervasively in Iranian culture?
Of course, I think it's both. And part of the reason why people have been talking about the nuclear bomb is that it gives them a sense of identity. The more they say, well, we are a power too, we exist, we want to be counted in the nuclear clan and in the nuclear game. And that speaks to, of course, an enormous identity crisis after 20 years of Islamic revolution. And when you think of the fact that these people are so very different from their leaders, they're humane, they have very private lives, they go about thinking their own thoughts, having their own political hopes and dreams. And of course they're taken aback, they're puzzled, they're frustrated to see that the government that represents them, unfortunately, is not an accurate image of who they are, but what they share is this deep sense of fear and, again, insecurity.
So what are the ironies? Because this government that is so repressive of any kind of dissident thought. I mean, just this week there was practically a riot by some Iranian students. A lot of rocks were thrown, some police went to the hospital, some students, there were arrests. That same government, someone like you, is asking us to take it slowly, to engage. There's no irony there?
Of course there is, but again, unfortunately, I don't believe that politics is necessarily the realm for morals. With Iran, you need a more pragmatic approach. Otherwise, we're on a collision course, and collision is not a good idea for Iran, because as we saw in Iraq, as you just said, we're not even talking about invasion, but if there are military strikes against Iran, the consequences can be devastating, both for the population of Iran and in terms of Middle Eastern geopolitics. So you have to try, in order to somehow divert this collision from happening, you must try to engage them somehow. We should try and open up Iran. Of course, that's counterintuitive, because when you're dealing with a very fierce enemy, you just want to antagonize it and threaten it and tell him you're going to crush him with all your might. But maybe that's not the right way. Opening the country is an enormous hope for Iran, because Iran is a very educated country, quite different in many ways from neighboring Arab countries in terms of the education of girls, for instance. 60% of students at the University of Tehran are girls. They can work, they can drive, they have public jobs. You have women in parliament, you have women lawyers, as we know because of the Nobel Peace Prize of 2003, Shireen Ebadi. There's an electoral process. You have a thriving civil society in Iran. And the more you give it a chance to speak, the more you are really fueling the hope of Iran. And there is so much of it. It's not just education, it's also youth. 70% of the country is under the age of 30.
Well, that's an important point, Leela, that it is a very young country, mm-hmm. as you say. But the Bush administration hasn't just been talking a war of words in the past 3 years. We have been trying, the United States has been trying to encourage change from within, mm-hmm. but it keeps getting pushed back.
We have to let time run its course. I think there is great hope for democracy in Iran, but it's not going to be tomorrow. Look even at the Soviet Union and Putin and all the convulsions. It might come 40, 50 years. I believe Iran might well be one of the first real homebred democracies of the Middle East, but it's not going to happen tomorrow. And I know in the meantime the situation is very tricky, it's awfully difficult and very, very complex, but there are still ways to talk to them before it's too late. And we must talk to Iran.
Well, Leela, thank you.
Thank you.
Journalist Leela Azamzankeneh is a social critic and a writer, as well as the editor of My Sister, Guard Your Veil, My Brother, Guard Your Eyes, Uncensored Iranian Voices.